Well, hi there. Welcome. I apologize that we got a little bit of a late start. We were getting baby changed, and I thought, well, I'm going to run downstairs and grab a snake real quick to show you guys. And then I made a horrible discovery, which is and I don't even know why I checked this snake, but I looked in another one and I found some mites, which I have no idea where they would have come from because I haven't brought anything in a long time. So I know what I'm going to be doing as soon as this is over, which is beginning mite treatment, which is oh so much fun. So if you have any questions about that, let me know. I'm not excited. I know mites are—they're not the worst thing that can happen. And in fact, I've only had them come up a couple of times. As long as you deal with them early, they're really not that hard to deal with. The main thing, and I'm kind of happy about this right now because of the reptile room. The main thing is if you have tarantulas, especially, mites are an arachnid. And so the mite treatments are very, very effective, but they can also end up killing your other arachnids, especially. I'm gonna take out my dubia colony, and the tarantulas are already gone there at the reptile room. And so I will begin mite treatment. Hooray! Oh, everyone should be so excited for me. But anyway, so sorry if I seem a little exacerbated. That's why. But I do have a lot of exciting stuff that I'm looking forward to sharing with you guys today, including the snake I went to go get, which is one I haven't shown to you guys before. I don't believe. If I have, I haven't talked to you about why it's so stinking rad. I thought about making a full video about it, but I think I'm just going to talk to you guys about it today. And
you got your super chat button. It's on the banister.
Wait, I don't have the super chat button. What if you guys send super chats?
Here he comes.
Oh, that was close. Okay, thank you guys. Thank you. All right. Yes, the most exotic animal I do have is a human child. Three now. You can hear one in the background. If she gets too out of control, we'll probably bring in remote Jason. But for now, I've got Leisha with me.
Hello.
So we'll hope for the best. Yeah. So if you have questions about any of the crazy stuff Leisha's been doing, feel free to ask her questions as well, because she's been doing amazing things of late. But yeah, here, should I show a thing? Should we start with a thing? Yeah. Okay, I will show you a thing. I have many things to show you guys today that I'm pretty excited about, but this is one, okay? It turns day into more day and night into day. And this is a black light. And I just got these in because tonight, I've been doing a little bit of casual herping with my family. But tonight, I'm going to go with my friend Kevin and Owen. And we are going to go out to the desert and begin my great herping adventure of the summer.
And Owen's good. Tell him what he spotted last time before
we went. So Owen, last time we went herping, we found a lot of cool stuff actually. But we went to a place where I sometimes will find rubber boas. And I love me some rubber boas. And so the thing about rubber boas are very different from other snakes. I find as a herper, I'm very auditory. You know, I listen really well for things, and then I can locate them quickly. Rubber boas don't work like that, because rubber boas, they hardly move. And if you spot one, you have caught one, because they hardly move. And they're just delightful little souls. But you got to notice it. And I walked right by one, and Owen spotted it. And so we found a rubber boa on our last time out. But I'm not counting that.
And there's a picture of it on the Instagram.
Yes, our Instagram. I have a picture. I took a ton of video because I'm thinking about doing a full video on them as pets. Because they are really cool. The thing is, I don't want to take one from here out of the wild as a pet. If for no other reason, I mean, obviously, I don't really like doing that to wild populations, though they are controlled, you know, by the state, and you are allowed to take some from the wild, though their populations will be fine. But the population here is really, really difficult to get feeding on, you know, commonly available feeders. And so this population is not an ideal rubber boa population for the pet trade. I do think they're awesome. So I got a bunch of footage of that one so that we can make a video on rubber boas in the future. So let me know if you'd like for us to do that sooner or later. I have.
Wait, don't tell them yet.
Well, I'm not going to tell them what's on it, but I have an exciting list. So going back to the herping, I have a really, really fun thing I'm excited about that I'm going to be doing all summer, and hopefully we'll be able to make a video or a few videos about this because we finally have the equipment. My time out with Dave Kaufman has shown me how to make in the field herping videos. And we tried it a couple summers ago.
We have tons of cool stuff here in Utah.
Yes, we have tons rad cool stuff. And so I have a list of things that I hope to be able to show you guys this summer. And I'll go through that sometime during this podcast.
It's going to be an exciting live stream because we have an exciting package to open.
Yes, we do.
We have already some super chats coming in. We have a whole list of your herping scavenger hunt with some awesome stuff on it. And we have some really good Patreon questions too.
So. Oh, well, we should probably get going on some of these questions and we'll just sprinkle things in.
Okay. So some super chats. There you go.
Yeah.
Robin George says, howdy, how do vet prices compare with dogs/cats?
Oh, vet, going to the vet is much cheaper than getting a dog or a cat. But I really don't know. I you know, we have a dog. So vet prices overall for a reptile, probably considerably less than for a dog or a cat, just because there's less sort of routine maintenance and shots and things like that for a reptile. If you do need to go to the vet, it's been my experience, because medical bills can be scary, right? Because sometimes they're super high and you don't know how much they're going to be until after you're done. Vets are not quite like doctors in that way. They'll usually tell you up front what things are going to cost. And I find, you know, vets, it's not like it's a super cheap thing, but it's also relatively affordable, especially when we're talking about saving your pet. And that's usually why you go the most often for reptiles, because there is something a bit wrong and you're needing to take care of it.
Awesome. Jaden said, my ball python named Georgia says hi.
Well, hi, Georgia.
And he also says, just graduated, best Utah college for zoology.
For zoology? I would have to look into it. So the University of Utah or Utah State might be really good, but I would need to see what their programs are like exactly. I know Utah State has some really good stuff. BYU doesn't have a zoology department or a zoology major. You can major in biology and you can take a lot of animal courses. And so that's in Utah. My undergraduate was at Colorado State University, which I should make a video sometime soon about my academic adventure that I've been on. But, you know, I grew up a fan of the University of Kansas. And so when I was in high school, that was the only school to which I applied and I got in, and that was the end of that. I wasn't really even concerned about it. And then sort of at the last minute, I decided, you know, I don't know if I want to go so far away from home. And so I applied to the schools in Colorado that were still accepting applications, which it was Colorado State and the University of Northern Colorado. And I got into both of those schools and I ended up going to Colorado State, and I was only planning to go for a year, but I loved it there. And they just so happen to be very excellent in zoology. And so, you know, the University of Kansas is well known for herpetology, or at least it was at the time. And so, you know, that's what I wanted to do. But I wound up doing zoology at Colorado State, and I loved it. I loved it there. So that's not Utah, but that's what I know more.
Awesome. Isabel B. from the live chat, she said, hey, Clint, just wanted to say thank you for making videos about all these amazing animals. You're so cool.
Well, thank you.
Super nice.
You guys are awesome.
All right, let's go to Patreon. You want to go to Patreon?
Let's do it. Yeah, Patreon. We still need a Patreon button.
Can I do it?
Yes.
Patreon.
Ooh, she's got it. She did excellent.
Okay. Betty Morgan says, could you do an episode about target training, a very food-motivated tegu? And then she talks about her tegu.
I think that would be great. I, you know, really, we do need to do a target training video. It'll be a very different sort of video for us, so we'll have to figure out exactly how to do that. But, you know, I honestly, Gus was almost an accidental target training at first. And then, you know, I noticed that it was happening with him, and I went, oh, well, I'm going to be a little more deliberate about this. Being food motivated makes things like that very easy.
Awesome. Let's see. Robert Watson says, hello, Clint. A lot of people talk about having a connection with their pets that they feel is a mutual emotional bond. After watching your video with Kevin McCurley, I'm aware that there is the concern in the reptile keeping hobby of people imposing mammalian or anthropomorphic thoughts onto their reptiles. With all that in mind, I want to ask you two interconnect questions. Firstly, in your experience as a reptile keeper, have you ever felt a special connection with any of your reptiles? I don't necessarily mean an emotive connection, though if you have, I'm curious about that too, but a sort of mutual engagement of intelligent interaction. Secondly, I know you've spoken about reptile intelligence in general a little bit on previous videos with a slight focus on arch lizards. I'm specifically interested in your thoughts, experiences when it comes to the more intelligent species of snake. My interest here is if any of the reptiles you mentioned in regards to the first part of my question also fall into the second part. Thanks again for sticking with this one.
Okay, so the second part is about snakes specifically?
Yeah, so he says just that you mentioned monitors in the house market, their intelligence, but he's specifically wondering about snakes.
Okay, so there's a lot to that question. So it's sort of about, you know, have I ever felt like I have a bond with reptiles? And I will be perfectly honest, that is the thing that I like the most about keeping reptiles or interacting with animals in general, is this opportunity to connect with them. And I, you know, I would have some difficulty teasing out exactly what is going on, but I feel generally like I have a heightened ability to do that. I was talking to you about how I'm going herping with my friend Kevin, and you know, when we're out in the field, you know, I'll pick up lizards that'll be panicky, but I can just tell when they're, you know, when they're kind of letting down and relaxing, and I feel like
Clint's
I can tell.
A lizard whisperer for real. Anytime we go herping, he will literally put a wild lizard on his finger or on his shoulder, and they will stay there the entire time. The entire time. He's a freaking lizard whisperer in real life.
So I absolutely think you can have a connection with them. I don't mistake that connection for being like a connection that you have between people, because they're not people. You need to appreciate them and connect with them for what they are and understand them for what they are. And, you know, that's what I really love so much about Kevin McCurley's insights, is because he, as far as that kind of connection goes with animals, he is exactly like I am. He's just been doing it longer. And so he has insights that I haven't yet gained, but I love that interaction, that getting to be there and share their space and observe them. You know, I love it when you can be around them and allow them to relax in such a way that they begin to behave normally, because then you really get to see what that animal is all about. And so I absolutely think this is the case. Snakes, 100%, 100%, you know, and there are some very intelligent snakes. You know, my false water cobra, the interactions with that are very different than with a lot of other snakes. You know, ball pythons are more sort of laid back, and, you know, the species matters a lot there. And I can't tell you necessarily that some are more intelligent than others. I think we have a bias towards visually based animals. I think we can understand the way that they're perceiving the world a lot better. And snakes are very, very olfactory, and not most of them are not highly visual. And so they're in a very different world than we are. And it's important to keep that in mind and understand that. But there's definitely considerable intelligence there, and you can definitely have a connection with them.
Hope, I lost the comment, but Hope, I don't know what the last name was, said that they're wearing your merch today, and their mom got it for them for their adoption anniversary.
Holy cow! Oh, that is so exciting, and I'm so glad that you guys could celebrate that with some of our awesome shirts. I love them so much. You know that all of those are created by our team, except for there's one that has my face on it that was created by Teespring. It's like not a photograph, but it's like a cartoon me. But the rest of them, they were all created by Will or Michelle. Leisha. Oh, and one was done by a fan, the Black Widow one.
Yeah, she's really pretty.
Yeah, so we feel a special connection to all of our merch, and I hope you're enjoying it. I wore my Penny and Guska shirt all day yesterday, mm-hmm. and my Clint Reptiles the day before that, because we took Big Daddy out to a park just to give some people something cool to see, because it's been a while since we've been able to see cool things like that.
Back to Patreon.
Patreon. There you go.
Eric Brown says, "Hi Clint, I'm working on an enclosure setup for a tegu, and I can't wait to get my dream reptile. Are there any certain breeders you recommend
for a tegu?" I know there are some
Erica Brown, I think is it.
Okay, there are some great tegu breeders. Most of them are going to be like in the Southeast, or in California, where it's hot and they can keep large numbers of tegus outdoors year round. You know, those are some of the really good ones. I'm trying to remember who all has them. I bet Ty Park has them. I'd hate to list too many people, because there are a lot of great ones. Any of them, you know, that you can get captive bred and you can contact the breeder, they're probably pretty awesome. Tegus need so much space and so much care and food and stuff like that. The people that breed them, it's more of a passion project than it is about dollars and cents.
Let's see. Alicia Mead said, "Hey, Clint, is it common for male snakes to go off food during the spring? We have a juvenile rat snake who has become very active, will not eat, and has been prowling around his enclosure. I think he's looking for a
lady." Oh, he's looking for the ladies. Yeah, it is. The main thing will be just to... you probably don't, because it didn't sound like you have multiple snakes. But if you've got females, he smells them and he's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And every now and then, males will stop eating and they just won't start again, because they're just all day, every day, just like, where's the lady? Where's the lady? Where's the lady? And eventually they die. So you do have to be careful about that. But it's not something that happens all the time. I wouldn't worry about it too much with your rat snake. But if it starts to get really, really skinny, probably take it to the vet.
Susan Marquette says, "I'm having a hard time finding good substrate mix for my monitor, Varanus primodorius.
Okay.
They live in the same climate / location as the Aki monitors. What would you recommend?"
I've been experimenting with substrates a little bit with my Aki. So Dave Kaufman did Akis in the wild, and one of the things that he noticed was that down in their burrows, and I know you're not talking about an Aki, but you might be talking about a Pilbara rock monitor. I'm not sure. I don't know all my scientific names off the top of my head. But down in their burrows, it was like 100% humidity, even though, you know, it's a deserty environment above. And so I've been trying to come up with a substrate that holds moisture. And what I've been using so far has been an EcoEarth sand mix. Which kind of holds its form a little bit for them to burrow, and also will hold some moisture. So I've been experimenting with that lately. That's been what I've been using. You can also use sand with them. Just make sure that they're shedding okay on their toes.
Awesome. Super chat.
Oh.
Retro Cruise says, "What are your opinions on sailfin dragons?"
I think sailfin dragons are really cool. Everybody loves them. I need to do more research into exactly what is going on with them, because everybody's obsessed with them and they're not ridiculously expensive. And yet I know almost nobody who has one, which is why we haven't done a video on one. Our local aquarium has a few, and they've got this really interesting enclosure. I don't know how I feel about it, but it's a colossal enclosure, and it's got sailfin dragons and green tree monitors in it. And
probably not the best setup.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. You know, the sailfin dragons are mostly on the ground. The tree monitors are up high. When they come to the ground, the sailfin dragons chase them around. I spend some time watching this. But the monitors are smart enough to kind of avoid it. I don't know. Here's the thing with cohabitation in general. It can be really neat, and it makes a lot of sense in a lot of ways, but it definitely opens you up to some serious risks that wouldn't be there otherwise, and they've got them. But yeah, I'll need to do more research definitely before I'll feel comfortable doing a video on them. I need to find somebody that has one. It's like, why does nobody have one? I'd like to know.
EIEKAL1, just in the live chat, said, I'm planning on buying a croc monitor and putting it in the dog costume to fool my wife. Do you think this will work?
Nope. Can't say that it will.
Probably talk to your wife about it.
Yeah, yeah. That might be the thing you want to chat about first.
Matt Gisconian says, hi, Clint. I remember you doing a bioactive setup before. More and more people I know are moving to bioactive for the reptiles. Does this mean tubs and vivs are behind the tens?
Well, a vivarium that's bioactive, it's arguably behind the times. I mean, it just depends. There are a lot of reasons to do different sorts of enclosures. One of the nice things about bioactive, there are a couple things. One of them is you can make beautiful planted enclosures that you don't have to tear apart all the time. And just generally, they're lower maintenance as far as taking the whole enclosure apart and cleaning it all up and doing substrate changes and things like that. So, you know, they take care of themselves much better, which is really, really nice, and they're prettier. Now, you know, if you stay on top of your maintenance of other sorts of enclosures, they work just great too. It's just kind of a pain in the neck. And as far as tubs go, there are some species that just do better in something that's not made of glass and without a screen top and stuff like that. And so, you know, they're like ball pythons, at least in a dry climate, like where I live, you know, they seem to do a lot better in a more tub sort of setup than in a glass aquarium sort of setup. So a lot of it just depends on the species.
Steve Johnson sent a $10 super chat.
Well, thank you, Steve.
As a person just getting into dwarf monitors, there are so many different variations of kings, rock, etc. It's a bit overwhelming. Are there any you would recommend or are overlooked? Thanks as always.
There are lots of red dwarf monitors. Some of them are more shy than others. I think the Aki is the ultimate, and it's one of the more affordable dwarf monitors, and it's one of the more available dwarf monitors. And so, you know, the Aki is spectacular. I have a Tristis monitor, which it's okay. I think it's a better looking monitor than an Aki, but it's more shy than an Aki. Timors are the same way. And, you know, a lot of the others. That's the main thing is the Akis have such a good personality. And that's really the best thing about them. They're small, reasonable to keep, awesome personality, bold. And even they can be a little bit shy. I need to. Mine's getting less and less shy as he's getting older. But he was pretty shy as a baby.
Alex Messips sent a super chat.
Oh,
there you go. Normal for a BCA to ignore his hides. Never seen him in one. Has both in warm and cool areas. Prefers hanging on branches. Eats well. Mm-hmm. Seems happy.
Juvenile common boas tend to be more arboreal. And then when they get older, they move down onto the ground more. And so if he's hanging up, if he's hanging out up in the branches, it seems like normal young boa imperator behavior. So I wouldn't worry about it.
Let's see here. There's some good live chat questions coming in. Do you want to do some
stuff?
Yeah.
Yes. Let us here. I want to do this because I haven't actually seen this yet.
Ooh, that's exciting. Are you sure you want to do that right now?
Well, I have many exciting things. I have many exciting things. Okay. So, this was sent to us. It says that it was sent from within the United States. But I know that this was sent by Newt's commander. And so...
And where does he live?
In London, I believe, or over
does
in England.
He tell us?
Well, the real... But he's got that suitcase thing that he can use.
Oh, I see.
So, you know, and he's no muggle.
Uh-huh.
So he can probably get here quickly, and it was probably cheaper to ship if he just came over here. Yeah, he's no nomad. So anyway, but he asked us, you know, of all the things that could be 3D printed, what would we most want sent? And there you are, Newt.
What is he saying?
Please read the letter too. So here's the box. And there's a letter, okay? And I've been told to read the letter. So I will read it. Hopefully, I'll have to read it fairly quickly. Okay. Well, hi there, Clint. Well, hi there, Newt. I'm Newt's commander, but I'm secretly not actually Newt, but Carson. Okay, so it's one of his magic tricks. I'm actually 13 years old. I live in Michigan. I don't remember how I found your channel, but it was around 8 months ago. And probably from Snake Discovery, or I found Snake Discovery through you.
Are you going to read the whole thing right now, or do you want to read it a little later?
Well, he told me to read it right now.
Okay.
I'm going to read it real quick. Okay, I know that Dave Coffin's Reptile Adventures and Coop's Reptiles, I know that I found Dave Coffin's Reptile Adventures and Coop's Reptiles through you. Both are awesome, and you should subscribe to all these channels. Both amazing and highly underrated channels. About 9 weeks ago, as you know, I got a notification on my phone for a live stream. But it wasn't on Thursday. I just thought that you decided to do the first social distancing with Clint before it had been an official name a day early, and I didn't pay attention to the channel name. Ah! It turned out that it was an educational live stream, and it wasn't on the main Clint Reptile channel, but your super secret private channel that I will not name here to keep private. So, yeah, I just have my own channel that I don't really use for anything. I just used to put, you know, silly little videos and things of remote control cars or a lizard or something like that on there before, long before we did this. And I was using it to do live streams for my college classes. I just thought it was the live stream about biology. So I said hi in the chat and you said, Newt's Commander, I didn't know that you were in my class. Then I realized that this is one of your college classes, even though I not only understood it, but loved it. I'm in fact a eukaryotic Bob. Not only one of those primordial, not Bobs. Ah, that was the day. I was talking to them, I think, about prokaryotes and how the prokaryotes are just all the non-eukaryotes. They're not even each other's closest relatives. It's just what they have in common is they're all not eukaryotes, in the same way that I could make a group called Bobs and all the non-Bobs would have in common is that they're all not Bob. Speaking of educational videos, I've watched the whole Ball Python genetic series and loved it. I couldn't believe that when I started to reach the end of the series, there were only around 600 likes. To put that into perspective, your latest video, Top 5 Small Pets for Beginners, has almost 6,000. Really? That was fast. Holy cow.
It has almost 6,000 likes?
No. I wish that the educational videos would do better so we could have more. I would also love to see an episode on Columbia, Livia. It has quite a few morphs, but most people just don't think of them as pets when they see them in the wild. I only learned about the morphs recently when reading On the Origin of Species. Also, please check out my YouTube channel. I'm pretty sure that you'll find it as the comments of most of your videos I've made in the last few months. I uploaded a video of the embryological development of the American toad about a week and a half ago. Carson/Newt. All right. Thank you so much, Carson. I am super excited about this, and I've been seeing you come up for a long time, so thank you for being such a great supporter of our channel.
What does the lid say? Show them.
Well, it's going to give away. It says Carno Skull. Yes, it's supposed to be in two pieces. So this is my first time seeing it. I haven't seen it. It looks like paper! Oh, wow. All right. There's the top bit.
That's awesome.
And the bottom jaw. Holy smokes. Let's see if I can get them together just right. This is so cool. I need to learn how to do 3D printing because, oh, look at it. It's a Carnotaurus skull. Because
open and close.
Okay, hang on. Ah, it's awesome.
The bottom jaw opens.
Ah. Anyway, this is what I'll be doing for the rest of the day, if you're curious. Thank you so much, Carson. I really appreciate it. This was so thoughtful and probably my favorite dinosaur. Though you know I have trouble with my favorites. Can I address that for a second?
Yeah.
Because lately when I talked about the Cuvier's dwarf caiman, being possibly my very favorite reptile. People are like, you say all of them are your favorite. No, I say a lot of them are among my favorites, because a lot of them are ones that I like a whole lot that we've covered. But the Cuvier's dwarf caiman might be number one on my list, which is crazy. I got another one that has potential to be up there, which is the common snapping turtle. And I love them like maybe the very most of all. And Carnotaurus is sort of that for me with dinosaurs. That is so cool. Thank you so much. All right.
Some super chat.
Super chat.
Super chat. Super chat. Super chat. Not here on the, what do you always say?
Trolley.
No, you're on. Northern Exotic sends a super chat. In about 2 weeks, I'll be celebrating my 10,000 subscriber goal. Huge thank you for being my idol, Clint. You are the king.
10,000, that is a big deal. That's Northern Exotics. Northern Exotics, correct?
Uh-huh.
That is so rad. And, like, when you get that many subscribers, it's apparent that you're making really awesome content. And, that not everybody ever gets there. Not even close. So, congratulations. That's a big deal.
A jar of pickles sent to Super Chat. And the picture is a jar of pickles. One of them says message attracted, so I don't know.
Okay, undo.
Yeah. The other one says, question, could you do a video on the Black Mamba?
Yes.
Why are you giggling?
Well, because that is a video that would make our King Cobra video seem sane.
Oh, dear.
I don't know. If I know anybody with a Black Mamba, but if I find somebody with a Black Mamba, who I have a friend who just recently got his permits. And so I don't know what he plans to get, but crazy stuff. We might have access to some more insanity soon. And a Black Mamba, that about takes the cake for nuts.
Is she asleep?
Yes.
Oh, good. Some people are asking to see her again, so maybe we'll show her at the end.
We'll show her off at the end if she's awake.
She's in one little onesie. I love babies in onesies. Don't you want to bite their legs? Okay, some more super chats. Let's see. Jaden says, my ball python was in pre-shed for a few days. She never ended up shedding and is no longer showing signs of pre-shed. What's that about? Love you guys.
So if you watch snakes when they shed, I don't know how long ago you're talking about, but if your snake's eyes get all milky and the belly gets milky and their pattern, they get kind of dull looking, it's because they're getting ready to shed their skin and they're growing a new skin underneath their old skin. Right before they shed, everything clears back up because the new skin is ready to go and it's just as clear as the old skin was. And so their eyes will clear back up, and usually that night they shed. So if you're talking about that it cleared back up, it probably means that within the next 24 hours, that snake's going to shed. If it just magically didn't shed, you might want to look around that enclosure for a shed skin. Otherwise, I have no idea what's going on. Something odd.
Retro Crew sent another super chat. What are your opinion on Gila monsters?
That they're stinking rad and they're on my list.
Jason said, just texted me. Just a reminder, make sure the laptop is plugged in.
Oh, we did.
I plugged it in, Jason.
Plugged in.
Don't you worry.
80%, 88% battery. Good call, Mr. Jason. Should I read my list?
No.
Okay.
Well, I have a question. Yes, we definitely need to read it. But I have a question for this person.
Yeah.
This person has an account, and the name of their account is Clint's Reptiles Fan. Do they have like 10 different accounts for their most beloved YouTube channels, or is this literally just their one account? They have a good question. So answer Clint's Reptile Fan.
Wait, there's a Laszlo on here. My favorite high school biology teacher, his name is Laszlo. And he's the only Laszlo I've ever known. And he's from Transylvania. I don't know where you're from, other Laszlo. Please let me know.
Okay, Clint's Reptile Fan says, can you tell me why my crested gecko won't eat?
I don't know how much it's not eating. So a few things. It could be eating crested gecko diet and you're just not noticing it. And what you could try doing is putting a slightly smaller quantity of crested gecko diet in the cup. And what you might notice are little tongue marks down in it. When I'm concerned that I have a crested gecko that's not eating, I do try some live feeders with it just so I know it's getting something. And I also weigh them fairly regularly so I can tell if they're dropping weight or not. It could be an issue with temperature or humidity that has it stressed. It might not like the particular crested gecko diet that you have. I've always had pretty good success with all of my crested geckos eating the crested gecko diets I've offered to them, but I hear people talk about how there's like one kind over another. So you might try a different flavor or a different brand. These would be things to try out.
Laszlo's from Hungary.
You're from Hungary. Awesome. Well, that.
And people are now saying that they're hungry.
Well, of course, I've in my life, when I was like, maybe 12 years old, I went on a cruise with my family because my dad had been at the same company for 20 years. And they sent us on a cruise. And we had people that like served our dinner every night, and they were from all over the world. And there was one of our servers was from Hungary, and the other one was from Turkey. And the one from Turkey was very afraid of the one from Hungary. But it was true. That's what they said.
That's a true story.
That is a true story. That wasn't just me doing a dad joke.
Yeah.
That's a true story. Sure that was their you. Dad joke.
Not sure I believe you. Aaron Puente says, video on rough green snakes. That was a super chat, by the way. Woo! Thank you, Aaron.
Video on rough green snakes?
Yeah.
I'd like that. Rough green snakes or smooth green snakes. We've got, I've actually got green snakes on my list because we've got them native around here. But I've never seen one yet.
Allison Wright says, how do you decide a good, I like this question. How do you decide a good hide size for your snake?
That is a great question. Depends a little bit on the species of snake, but usually when a snake is looking for a hide, it's looking for a place that it fits in, but that's pretty cozy. So, you know, find something that it could be curled up inside of and easily fit in there, but not be so spacious that it doesn't really feel like it's in a hide at all.
Okay, some more super chats coming in. Thank you. Now you're on the trolley.
There I go.
Oz sent a $10 super chat.
Thank you,
Oz. Could you do an advice video regarding researching care for uncommon snakes in the pet trade? Example, I have a Madagascar speckled hognose rescued, and info is very hard to find on most things Madagascar.
Yeah. That'd be fun. I can give you a few tips right now, too, as far as just how to research, especially uncommon reptiles. Well, I'm a member of a group on Facebook that is for rare and uncommon reptiles. And so that's a really good one. It's full of people that keep unusual stuff. Also, there are oftentimes groups on social media for uncommon reptiles or your specific uncommon reptile that you're keeping, depending on exactly how uncommon we're talking. And so, you know, there might be a group on Madagascar hognose snakes. I'm in some groups on the indigo snakes and the other Kribos right now. I even though I don't keep any of those, just because I want more good information about them. And, you know, I see the things that they're talking about, the care sheets that they recommend, they're often discussing their questions about care. And so joining groups like that, I find to be really, really helpful. And they'll be able to point you to specific care sheets that are probably the best for whatever it is you're keeping.
Awesome. Thanks, Clint. More super chats. Thank you, you guys.
Super chat! Super chat!
Nick Gaming says, hi, Clint. A lot of the time you make a video about a lizard, you say that they need calcium powder. I'm wondering how in the wild they get this calcium.
Okay, so that's a great question. Is how do they get proper amounts of calcium in the wild and vitamins and things like that? One of the things that's a big, big deal is every animal in the world is well adapted to the food and environment in which they occur naturally. And so a lot of times they're eating a very diverse diet and they're also well adapted to the nutrients available in that diet that's available where they are. Well, we're not actually providing that diet to anything. There's kind of a small number of feeder species that we're feeding to everything from everywhere in the world. And so we are not giving them the diet that they're adapted to eating. And in a lot of cases, there are specific nutrients, calcium often being one of them, that they're not getting enough of. In addition, in the wild, they're getting exposed to, say, you know, 10 to 14 hours of direct sunlight and high amounts of UV and UVB. And, you know, and that's available to them in whatever quantities they want, you know, and they are well adapted to the amount of UV that they're typically getting. And so that's very, very good for their calcium development. Well, in captivity, I mean, we're doing the best we can with UV bulbs. Where possible, we're keeping them outdoors, but they are not getting the same sort of UV exposure in captivity. And so metabolic bone disease is a very, very real concern in captivity, and proper calcium supplements can really reduce that.
Awesome. Kirchow sent a $3 super chat with just a funny little pigeon giving a thumbs up. Thank you for the super chat.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And George Plews just sent a $5 super chat.
Wow.
Nice. Thank you, George.
You guys are awesome.
And let's see what else. I just saw Clint's Reptiles Rocks. Name?
That's the name?
I don't understand. Do these people just...
Oh, yeah. Clint's Reptiles Rock.
Yeah.
What in the world?
I know.
Yeah. You guys are awesome.
Yeah.
You guys are awesome. I can't believe... there's a group on Facebook for Clint's Reptiles fans. You know, I just stumbled into it one day. And I was like, what in the world? That is so cool. And I joined the group just because I wanted to see what was going on in Clint's Reptiles fans. And, you know, but I don't run it or anything like that. But, you know, I do see that they talk about really cool stuff. And it's just like, it is so neat that you guys are out there and you're helping build this community and make it stronger, because it is like the best online community, the best real community anywhere.
I love this community. I love these guys. I love these people who come. I was telling Clint last time that I was this person, whatever we call me. Last time I did the live chat with you, I felt when we talked about Martha and her birthing story, I felt like we were just sitting down with a group of friends. Like,
absolutely.
It was very intimate. It was very personal. And I just felt like a real connection. And I think that most of the time you don't get that online. There's so much hostility and anger and malice online. But with this community, it's just so, you guys are awesome.
You guys are the best. And, you know, and I've really enjoyed doing these social distancing live streams with you guys, because, you know, as time's gone on, it's like it is just more and more, you know, sitting down with friends, and like I recognize a lot of your names as you come up, and it's really cool. It's really cool.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for being the way you are.
Do you want to share a couple things on your list now?
Yeah, well, I've got a lot of things I should share. I should maybe just share the list.
Yeah. We have some Patreon questions too.
Okay. Well, I'll share my list, but I'll save my extra credit portions of my list for later.
Extra credit?
Yes.
Ooh.
So this list is entirely Utah herbs, because I'm not sure how much I'll be able to get out of the state this summer, if that'll even be a thing. I do think we're at least talking to Dave Kaufman. He's going to try to come down, so we might do some serious herping. But I have been, ever since this channel has existed, I have been ridiculously overworked in trying to do a ton of jobs. And right now things have slowed down as much as ever for me, really, in my adult life. And one of the things that I really want to do is take you guys herping. And so I have made myself a list. Now, some of these things are things I've never seen in the wild before.
People are asking, what is the list for? So quickly explain that.
So I decided that I was going to give myself a reptile scavenger hunt this summer. And I don't know if I'll be able to get everything, but I am going to try darn hard to knock off everything on this list. This is my reptile scavenger hunt 2020.
Look, this is a good idea. Somebody said GoPro herping. You should wear a GoPro while you do it. That's awesome.
That is a good idea. Well, yeah, we don't have a GoPro just yet.
My dad does. Steal my dad.
We might have to. We will. That's a fun idea. I don't know how you do sound with GoPros, because they don't have any sound themselves.
Somebody. I think the new ones do.
Ooh! If they have sound, then I can sync them up. Okay. Okay. We will have to find out about a GoPro, but I've definitely we've got some equipment.
That would be fun to get your perspective of catching the reptile.
Just all over the place, but they're motion stabilized.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. So some of these are going to be easy, and some of these are going to be hard. All right. Garter snake. I've already caught many of them this summer. I'm thinking about tweaking it because there are like two or three species of garter snakes here in Utah. And all I've ever seen in Utah are wandering garters. And I've seen a lot of them. So I may tweak that where I have to find one of the non-wandering garters. But we will see. We will see. Chuckwalla. I've never seen a wild chuckwalla. They're so cool. I might be frozen.
You're not frozen.
I'm not frozen? No. Okay, I'm frozen on mine.
You're not frozen on
mine. Okay, okay, okay. As long as I'm not frozen, I don't want you to miss any of these. So chuckwalla. I really would like to find a chuckwalla. Side-blotched lizards. And when I find them, I have an unbelievably cool story to share with you guys about side-blotched lizards. They might get their own video when I find side-blotched lizards. A king snake or a milk snake. We have both, and but I will be happy with either one. If I can get one or the other, I'm checking that off for the year. A horned lizard. I have found horned lizards before. I would like to do
horned toads, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I would like to do a horned lizard video for you guys, but I don't want to take one out of the wild. So I will get a lot of footage of horned lizards and then hopefully do a full horned lizard video for you guys.
That'd be fun.
Collared lizards. That will not probably be the collared lizard video, but because collared lizards, I actually know people that have collared lizards. People have been asking about them. We will do that. But my problem is my friends with collared lizards have routinely been potentially exposed to COVID-19.
Who?
And
don't say their name.
Yes, I won't. And so
I want to know.
As far as I know, they haven't actually had it, but I constantly have them on several week quarantine from me that I'm not going to be exposed to them. So collared lizard video may come. A spiny or fence lizard, something from the genus Scaloperus. A racer or a coach whip. Hopefully both, but I will be happy with either, especially if I manage to catch it because they are fast and cranky. A rattlesnake. I have never seen a wild rattlesnake in Utah.
I've seen
wild rattlesnakes. I know they're around. People see them often. I just have not happened to stumble into one, and I don't know why. But largely because I haven't had enough time since I've really been in Utah to do the amount of herping I would like to do. So I'm being ambitious.
That's about to change.
A leopard lizard, which I have seen here in Utah, and I love them. And Leisha's like, what's a leopard lizard? So cool. So cool. A skink of some sort. We have Western skinks and we've got some other skinks. I love skinks. I haven't seen a skink in Utah. But I know they're here and I will find them. A whiptail, which is just a tiny little tegu. And I find them often. We will definitely find us some.
One of the whiptails that stayed on your shoulder all day.
That is true. A turtle, a non-tortoise turtle. So here's a story. And I'm not going to count ones. So there's a pond that has on BYU campus that has a lot of turtles. And I often go there and look at the turtles. They don't count. Outside of that pond and the snapping turtle that we got that was wandering around other than the snapping turtles, which are invasive, and the ones in the pond that are just people's pet turtles that they've put in this on-campus pond, I have never seen a wild turtle in Utah. Which is crazy. Like, I hang out at water a lot. I've never seen a turtle here. I see turtles all the time in Colorado. When I go to Kansas, Missouri, Oklahoma, turtles everywhere. I've never seen a wild turtle in Utah. I'm going to try to change that. A banded gecko. I've only seen one here in Utah.
People are giving you really good advice of where to find these things. We're going out to Boulder next month.
Yep, and we're going to go down to St. George. We're going to have to go down to St. George quite a bit. Mm-hmm. So a lot of this stuff requires me to go to southern Utah, mm-hmm. and I'm really looking forward to it. A zebra-tailed lizard, which I've caught one once before here in Utah, down by St. George. The fastest lizard I've ever seen in my life. My gosh, I have no idea. Really, I know there was a butterfly net involved, and that's the only reason I was able to catch it because that thing is a blur. A zebra-tailed lizard. They're ridiculous. A Gila monster. I've never seen one of those in the wild. Yes. A tortoise. We have desert tortoises here in Utah. I would like to see one. A green snake, because we have green snakes. A rubber boa, and I'm not counting the one I saw the other day. A new rubber boa. A gopher snake, which I will definitely find. I find lots of gopher snakes, and I love them. Okay. Nice. I'll save my extra credit list, which is non-reptile stinking rad stuff for later.
Quite a few super chats came in, and they're all really super nice. Chat. So, super chat.
Oh my gosh! Okay.
let's see. Oh, the first one, Hannah Hayes sent a super chat. Have you ever had a crusty hatch out with fused toes?
Fused toes. I haven't had a fused toed one. I've seen online quite a few two-headed ones. Not a crusty gecko, but Emily's got an exciting. An exciting announcement for you guys in the near future.
Donovan Jones. We did a thing and purchased a hatchling savannah monitor. Any tips for taming the 6 inches of the terrorizing and biting mini dinosaur?
I would say more than worrying about taming it. You know, monitors are very food motivated. And so, you know, lots of good interaction that way with food involved. It'll probably be a reasonably nice little creature. You just have to really show it that you're not there to kill it. If you can give it a front entry enclosure, that would change your relationship a lot, because if you're coming in like an eagle every time, that's why it's terrified. More importantly, though, that monitor is going to need huge amounts of space. I mean, they just cover miles in the wild. That's what they do. They just run around all day long. And so give it huge amounts of space, huge amounts of heat, and lots of invertebrate prey, especially arthropod prey.
Awesome. Okay, here's where the nice ones come in. Oz sent a $5 super chat and said, no, thank you for being awesome, Clint. This was when we were telling them what an amazing community we have. And he said, no, thank you for being awesome, Clint. You and the team are such a ray of positivity and knowledge. We appreciate you all.
Well, you guys radiate that back to us, and what a wonderful cycle that is, because this world needs more positivity.
Definitely.
It can feel pretty dark. And this is something I've focused on a lot with my family, is the smaller the scale that you look at the world, the more power you have to shape it. And so, you know, when you look at the whole world's full of problems, huge problems. And, you know, you get closer, you look at your country, you know, there's still a lot of problems. You know, you look at your state, for example, you know, there are some problems. You know, your town, some, you know, you get down to your neighborhood and especially your home and your life, like, you have so much power to make it a better place. And it radiates out from there, right? You know, you make your life better, and it helps your family, you know, and your family get stronger and better, and it helps your neighborhood, and your neighborhood gets stronger and better, and it helps your town. Your town gets better and stronger, and it, you know, it helps your state, and your state helps your country, and your country helps the world. And it starts with you, and you have so much control over your little world. And so make it amazing. And I feel like, you know, we try to do that, and golly, I mean, we sure feel it coming back from you guys. And we are so thankful, because this is the kind of world I want to live in.
Awesome. Kirchow sent a $10 super chat. And I thought it was a pigeon, but it's actually a pear that's doing like
a pear? Kind of the same shape. Pigeons are a little bit pear-shaped. Yeah. I can see it.
So they thank just said you. Thank you, which is so nice.
You guys are amazing.
Ava sent a really fantastic idea. Post the list in the community tab, please. You're awesome, Clint. You inspired me to get my own ball python, and he's now at home. Sincerely, Ava. And Loki, the pastel banana leopard ball python.
I will figure out some way to make this list very accessible. So the community tab, that would be totally. I haven't even typed it up right. It's just handwritten so far. But I'll type it up.
It'll be a fun adventure this summer.
I'm really looking forward to it. We'll probably do a few videos. I'll try to, as I get a few of them, release it to you guys. I'm going tonight.
Cassie says, hi, Clint. Could you say happy birthday to Tommy? He's my brother, and it's my brother's birthday Sunday, and he loves your channel. It would mean the world to
me. Happy birthday, Tommy!
Happy birthday, Tommy!
I'm so excited for you. What are you guys doing for the birthday?
Donovan Jones sent a $5 super chat that said, thank you very much for the information.
Oh, you betcha, Donovan. Thank you. That's so nice of you.
Jacob Loom sent, I think CA is Canada, right?
I think so.
$50 Canadian money. Just a super chat with no question or anything.
My gosh.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. You guys, thank you so much. That is so kind of you.
We really appreciate the support and the help. It goes a long way.
It does.
That's what we do.
Yeah, because things are a little scary. And so we are so grateful. Thank you. It really helps tremendously.
Yeah. That's a great idea to put the list on the community.
I like it. I like it a lot.
Because then we can all keep track of it together. And hopefully when we edit the video, we can have the list kind of on the screen and we can be checkmarking them off.
That'd be fun. That'd be fun. Yeah, if we got the skills for that, let's do it.
Yeah. Okay, let's go to Patreon just for a minute. It's almost about time to be done.
Okay.
It's almost.
Well, I've got a few things I want to show them before I get done. But at some point, we'll get done with questions, and you will be free.
Thanks. Aquarimax Pets, a.k.a. Russ Wilson, said, some time ago, we adopted a 13-month-old corn snake. It had been fed very sparingly by the previous owner, and it weighed only about 50 grams when we got it. We immediately put it on more normal feeding regimen, and now about 20 months later, it weighs well over 400 grams and is about 44 inches long. A year or so ago, someone said that it had a small head for its body size. I've heard that this can be a result of underfeeding and or genetics. What do you think is more likely cause for a small-headed corn snake, or could it be both?
It could easily be both. So this is the discussion of genetics by environment interaction, G by E interaction, which is, does this snake have a small head because it has genetics for a small head, or does it have a small head because its growth was initially stunted during key head growth periods? And it would be hard to say. It could be either of those things or a combination of those two factors.
Awesome. Thank you. Let's see. Andrew Pearson says, hello, Clint. What is your favorite ball python morph, specifically under $500 as well as in general? Also, can you go over the difference between black-eyed leucism and blue-eyed leucism, other than the obvious difference in their eyes?
Okay. Yes, I can. So my favorite ball python morph, so there are some combo morphs that I love very, very much that are under $500. The one that I have with me today is not one of them. It's because it would be more, but I made it. But I love blue-eyed leucistics. I also love black-eyed leucistics, though a little bit less, for reasons I would be happy to tell you when we talk about the difference between them. And I love the blue-eyed leucistic complex generally, which is part of why I like them more. And I love the blue-eyed leucistic complex and the banana gene together. So one of them that I love is a banana lesser, which is, you know, I produce them every year because I breed things with the blue-eyed leucistic complex and I breed things with banana. Like that's sort of where I put my focus as a breeder, because I don't breed so many things that I breed everything in the world. So it's like you got to narrow down to what you love, and those genes go so well together. And a banana lesser, the interesting thing is I have a banana kingpin, which is a banana lesser pinstripe, who's been my main breeder male. And so I've never been able to justify keeping a banana lesser. But right now I have one from last year that I've held on to just because I love them so much. They're not even a super expensive snake. They're just gorgeous, gorgeous snakes. I'm going to get out this one just for a second. This is a little bit out of that price range, but it was what I wanted to show you guys. I don't even know. They're kind of expensive still because they're very, very difficult to breed. If you know very much about the banana morph,
Martha's sleep crying.
Oh, if you know very much about bananas, and it might be hard to see what this is, but this is a snake I produced last year, and this is a super banana. So this is a homozygous banana. And this is a very difficult snake to produce, because if you have a banana, like if you have a male maker, male banana, you can't just necessarily ever make one of these, even if you're happy with inbreeding. You must have both a male and a female banana. And if you don't understand why that's hard to do, you should watch our video on banana ball pythons. But this is a super banana. So all of his babies, males or females, will be bananas. And they don't get the spots that the heterozygous bananas get. And, I mean, the colors are like these pastel muted colors, but there's oranges and whites and purples and yellows. And they're not coming up very well on this camera, but I...
Joel Needham wants you to say super banana like you say super chat.
Super banana! Anyway, I am so excited about this snake. And, you know, probably next year, he'll be big enough to get into my breeding projects, which means that I will be able to produce a female lesser banana. And that, and I even have some blue-eyed leucistics. So if I breed him to one of my blue-eyed leucistics, all of their babies will be have both a leucistic gene and a banana gene. But getting back to the difference between black-eyed and blue-eyed leucistics. So a black-eyed leucistic is a homozygous fire, and a blue-eyed leucistic is a homozygous of two of the genes from the blue-eyed leucistic complex, usually not as much with mystic or special, though they're still blue-eyed leucistics, but they've got more color to them. But things like Russo, lesser, Mojave, though not homozygous Mojave necessarily, honey, there are some others that go in there as well. But homozygous versions of those are the blue-eyed leucistics, and they've got the blue eyes. The reason I like the blue-eyed leucistic complex more than the black-eyed leucistic complex, two reasons. One of them is a lot of the black-eyed leucistics have these yellow patches all over them, which some people like. It's almost like a piebald thing, but they're just white and yellow patched. And that's okay. You know, I like it. I just don't like it as well as the pure white snake. And the other thing is I don't like fires nearly as well as I like the blue-eyed leucistic complex genes. So when I get a heterozygote of the blue-eyed leucistic genes, I love them. Like, I love Mojaves and I love lessers. And fires are all right, but I'm not as excited about fires. And so the ones that aren't super fires, I'd be not all that excited about. Whereas I'm all kinds of excited about my heterozygous blue-eyed leucistic snakes.
Awesome. Garrison Sims, a patron, said, "Hey, Clint, what is your opinion?" This is a really good question. "What is your opinion on hunting? I thought it would be interesting to hear your perspective considering your professional and educational background. Thanks for the awesome content."
That is an awesome question I've never tackled before. So this is, what is my opinion on hunting? Personally, I do not like hunting. You know, like for me to go hunting for most things would, you know, like if I had to hunt to eat, I would have no problem with it. And you know, I eat meat, so I'm okay with somebody killing my meat. It would just bum me the heck out if I had to do it myself. And so I'm certainly not going to go do it for fun, because it just bums me out. All right. But that said, And as a kid, it just bothered me. It just made me sad. You know, I knew people that were hunters, and it just made me sad. And but at the same time, like, I could be eating a hamburger and I'm like, I'm so sad that you shot that deer. As I've grown older and I've learned more about ecology and management, especially in places where we've pretty much wiped out the natural predators, I'm really okay with hunting conceptually. I still don't really want to have to be the one that does it, but I'm really okay with people that do. You know, it's very important to me that it be well managed, and you know, there's a sustainable take, which is that, you know, you essentially, if you don't have a lot of natural predators out there, and you've got things like deer, if nobody's hunting them, what's going to happen is the population is going to become enormous, and what's going to keep them at their carrying capacity is going to be mostly disease and starvation. And so you're going to have massive starvation. I'm sort of more okay with a controlled hunt that keeps the population in a reasonable place so you don't have them just starving to death out in the mountains. And so as long as it's controlled and it's not leading to like the extinction of the population, I'm very, very okay with hunting. I just don't personally want to have to be the one that does it. I am feeling like I would like to understand better what goes into hunting. So I almost would like to accompany somebody who's hunting. Like, I don't want to have to do it unless I have to do it. But if I ever had to do it, I'd like to know how. And so I'd kind of like to apprentice, or, you know, go out with somebody hunting. Well, the kind of hunting I love all the things about hunting right up to the point where you shoot something. If I could just have a telephoto lens and take pictures of it at that point, it'd be a perfect day.
My brothers and my dad were all going to go up to Alaska on this huge boys trip to go hunt bears and get a bear. And Clint was like, I want to do that. I just don't want to see that bear die.
Yeah.
I want to go hike around in Alaska and see all the cool nature and animals and amazing things. See that bear in the wild. But then I would be so sad to watch it die.
And even if I'm like, can I photograph it for 5 minutes before you shoot it? I'd be bummed out looking at the pictures later. I'm like, they killed this bear right after these pictures were taken.
Yeah.
Like, it would wreck my day, week, month, whatever, you know, to have to watch that bear die.
Yeah.
I would rather go rabbit hunting with somebody so I can learn what goes into it. But I can handle rabbits. You know, I watch rabbits get eaten by snakes. That doesn't bother me. Probably if they were alive. I don't know.
Kirchhoff sent another $10 super chat with the pair saying thank you.
Oh, thank you. the pair pigeon.
Yeah, the pair pigeon.
Thank you so much. You guys are so kind.
Robin George said, did you ever name your carpet python I'm in love?
I haven't. I'm so noncommittal. We've had a hard time naming this baby, but yeah. We have arrived at Martha.
Yeah. We always knew it's Martha. The middle name was the hard.
Yeah.
King Me Jay Saunders says, hey, Clint, I'm looking to get a techie like Yes Gus. Is it okay to jump right in, or do you recommend something else first?
Oh, a techie, the thing about a techie, so some animals, the care is very difficult. And so I recommend not starting with them, even though some people are like, well, if you do your homework, yeah, but you know, you can do your homework and not really understand what you're reading if you haven't ever kept reptiles before. The thing about a tegu is it's not really any harder to keep than any other reptile. So, you know, it's easy. It's just big, right? So, you know, all the things that you would get for a smaller, easy to keep reptile, you just need big for a tegu. And so, you know, it's just as tolerant of mistakes as any other easy to keep reptile. Just big. Everything's big. Everything's big and expensive and takes up a lot of space. The one thing also that can be big with them is their bite. And
they're smart, so they get out a lot, like your enclosure.
Yeah, you got your enclosure needs to be they figure out how to open doors and stuff, so make sure it can be secured and locked.
That was Tanner's problem.
Yep, yeah. My brother-in-law that had Gus before I did, he kept getting out of stuff because he will do that. I mean he knows how to open his current enclosure, and so I've had to do things to secure it. He's clever at this. The thing about a tegu is you're going to want to learn to read him while he's small, because their bite can be pretty horrific, and they're very food motivated. So if he's coming at you with a food response, learn how to interpret that. So that'd be the only reason I would say having experience with other lizards first would be good. But really, it needs to be experience with other highly food motivated lizards that are smaller, like say a jeweled lizard or something like that. But where is it? There it is. I got a wound from a reptile bite the other day, yesterday. Leopard gecko. I had a dead cricket, and I was going to try to get it to take the dead cricket because they don't normally take dead stuff. And it was just fresh out of the bag. It had just died on the way home. And bit my thumb. I had it coming. I deserved it completely.
Nick Bohannon, a patron. I don't really understand this question. Maybe you can interpret it. I want to start doing more educational stuff. I had a date lined up at my daughter's preschool, but it got canceled due to COVID-19. What's a good way to approach the subject at our new school when it starts back?
I totally understand that question. Okay so we totally understand, because we just opened Clint's Reptile Room, and we were intending to do lots of schools and other educational programs and you know, social events, and then suddenly that's all gone. And so we have also been trying to figure out, you know, what do we do now? Like, how do we keep Clint's Reptile Room afloat? And it sounds like that's kind of, you know, to a much smaller degree, because I don't think you probably have the overhead we now have from the room. But, you know, I would say just reach out to them. Tell them that you do this kind of thing. It's a really cool educational opportunity for people. I mean, it's something that kids remember for their whole lives. And so it's super cool. It's really neat because it's an experience most people just don't have. And we have it so often that we don't even think about what an unusual and special thing it is. So just reach out to them and let them know that you do this and that you'd be interested in coming and sharing these amazing creatures with other people. I think that'd be great.
Dylan Harward said, "Hey, Clint, this is the boy that you met at Springville, not young Kevin. How are you?"
Not young Kevin. There, oh, just the other day?
And Harward, is your family with Harward Farms? Harward Farms are all
over. And was the question, how am I doing?
Yeah.
Doing so well. Doing so well, except I got to deal with mites now.
Nick Moore said, "Where do the behavioral and other differences between different tegu subspecies, Chacoan, Argentine, Colombian, Blue, Red, etc.?" It's a patron on Patreon.
Okay, so there are massive differences between these lizards, and so know the ones that you're interested in. The Chacoan and the Argentine black and white, you know, there's very little difference between them. Also the blue, and then to a greater degree of difference are the reds. Those are all really pleasant tegus. All the Colombian tegus, like the gold tegu, the Colombian black and white tegu, those tegus are smaller. They're a little bit smaller, and they're just a lot more nervous. They're more like a great big amoeba or whiptail lizard than they are like their bigger cousins, the Argentine tegus. And so if it's a lizard that you're not really wanting to see all that often or handle all that often, then they're great, right? Because they're smaller and a little bit more reasonable. But if it's something that you want to interact with in the way that I interact with Gus Gus, it's a much longer road with those tegus than it is with the Argentines.
Awesome. We have a few more super chats, and then I think you can say
super chat.
Because it's been over an hour.
Yes, you've been very patient, Lehi. Thank you.
Let's see. Where am I on these super chats? Okay, here they are. Jaden said, "Petition to name your carpet python Gilbert."
Gilbert.
Like Gilbert, Arizona. And let's see. Jazzy Cat said, "Hey, Clint." Really appreciate your videos. Your videos helped me make the decision to get my blue tongue named K-A-B-R.
Caber.
And my hognose snake named Shiro. Shiro.
Righteous. What great choices. Hogs and blue tongues are spectacular.
Why don't you own any venomous snakes?
I need to get permitting. And I mean, I have a false water cobra, and so that's a venomous snake. But I don't have any hot snakes. Yeah, I got hogs. I don't have any hot snakes. To me, at this point, it's not worth the risk or the effort that would go into the permitting. If I'm going to get a dangerous thing that I need to jump through all kinds of hoops to get, it'll be a crocodilian.
Clint's Reptile Fan says, "Hey, Clint, thanks for answering my question. Is there Clint's Reptiles merch for sale, and how can we get some?"
Yeah, so we've got a Teespring store. I think below all the videos, there's like a bar where you can click on it and go there. And so that's all the merch that we have right now is through Teespring. We may expand in the future. I don't know.
We want to have a specific Clint's Reptile Room shirt that you can only buy at Clint's Reptile Room.
That is the thing we want to do. We do want to have special merch just for at Clint's Reptile Room.
And Jason just barely pinned the link.
Oh, there it is. And we got, there's so much, it's so many cool designs. I'm really excited about the merch we have. I wear it all the time, actually.
Literally every day. Benny doesn't have to wear a shirt and tie. He's in Clint's Reptiles merch. All right. Should we show off this baby real quick?
We should show off the baby and
extra credit.
My extra credit.
You're right. Which one do you want to do first?
Baby or extra credit? You got 5 seconds to let me know.
They're a little bit behind. They're okay. About 10 seconds
behind. Okay, I'll give you 10 seconds. Baby.
Extra credit. Baby, extra credit. Baby.
Okay, baby's taking it. Oh, yeah. Should I take her? Stay asleep.
Is the snowball on?
Yeah.
That red light means it's working.
There she is. Oh, hang on just a second. Let's see if I can
hold her like this.
She's like, what is this about?
My makeupless face for hundreds to see. Hi, everyone.
She's so good.
Look at her little legs. Spink her cute little
She's
back.
Got some serious toes on her. You can't see them so well. Piano and her toes. Fingers. Yeah, she's got piano toes and fingers. Mm-hmm. They're enormous.
Cute. People are saying happiest daddy ever. That baby is so cute. She's so little, so small. Came expecting reptiles, saw a human baby instead. OMG, so tiny. Aw, so cute. The little fingers.
Aren't they the best?
Oh, show them those little toes up close.
Let's get a toes up.
A toes up. And that cute so little good. Face. Oh, it's dear. Not a great angle on her face yet.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm sorry.
Give her a cute angle.
I don't know how to position her because I want her to stay comfortable and sort of sleepy.
Infinite potential. Such a great animal. Baby noises. I love her, man. None of my nephews have been that size for years. Atosa, she's so scrunchy. Yeah. Oh, we love her.
Oh, there's some eyeballs. She's like, what are we on? Is this a live stream? And you got any super chats for me?
People don't know that babies talk through you,
Clint. Yeah, that's the other thing I do is I babies can talk through me, and she has had enough. You want to go back to mommy? You like her best? She's got all the goods.
Hi, baby.
Hey. Isn't she fun? Girl. Not in the middle of the night, but she is so fun all the rest of the time. Okay. Are you guys ready for the extra credit list? Okay, a frog. I do see some frogs in Utah. I think this is pretty doable. I maybe will expand this because there's like we've got canyon tree frogs here. We've got spadefoots, which I've never seen a wild spadefoot, and I love spadefoots. A salamander, we've only got one species, so I pretty much have to find the one. Hogna carolinensis. If you don't know what that is, and you probably do not, it is, I want to do a whole video on them. Once I find one, like I'm keeping one, and I'm going to do a whole video on these guys because I adore these. They are enormous wolf spiders. Like the size of a small tarantula wolf spider. And the difference there is tarantulas are tactile hunters. You know, they basically stand there and if something brushes the hairs on them, then they're like, oh, you're there. And they dive on it. These guys are visual predators, you know, and they'll spot something way across the enclosure. And they're fast and they're not for handling, but they are hardcore and awesome. Anyway, I hope to find one. A tarantula, because we do have some here in Utah, and I've found them before. A tarantula hawk, pompiliid wasp. They're scary and rad. A scorpion, tonight. Okay. A tiger beetle. If you don't know what a tiger beetle is, you should look up tiger beetles. A sun spider, a sulfugid. They are really cool, not spiders. An ant lion, because they are bodacious. A velvet ant. Very excited to find one of those for you guys. I did recently find a jumping spider that is a velvet ant mimic, which is stinking rad.
Smooth Cat says Utah has great horned owls.
That's true. We've seen one on on Antelope Island. Mm-hmm. We hung out with a great horned owl for a long time. A thick-waisted wasp, a horned wasp. I would like to find one of those. And an assassin bug. Those are the things that I've added to my extra credit list so far. I may expand it even further. It's an exciting summer. I am so excited. And it really kicks off this evening for me. So I've done some hobby hike herping, but this is my first dedicated herping trip of the year. And hopefully the first of many, 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 many. So, whew, thank you guys for being here with us today. I am so excited about the things that I got to share with you guys. Thanks for being who you are. You're
being
amazing
so
people.
Oh,
yeah.
Kind and
you're just the greatest.
Wholesome.
For real. For real. Like, it is just really touching and amazing. And we are so thankful for you. So hang in there. Have a great week. Remember that the world right around you can be a wonderful place and that you have a lot of control to make it amazing. And as always, like and subscribe. And we hope to see you real soon.